We really believe that we can get around with immune systems by targeting three different target assets. But our ambition has really increased significantly recently. And those are the results we have had from the Matin's trial targeting the macrophage reprogramming. It's really based on the scientific involvement of a brand new target, which obviously is a proprietary. And we have a clinical program, which we think we can really tackle the major problem in the cancer area, and that is the immune suppression. Why cancer causes immune suppression is very clear. Cancer cells do not want to have immune cells around them. They believe that they are their enemies and they want to get rid of them. And they have learned to do that during the evolution. And we believe that with the current program, this is really providing very important and significant results. And obviously, those are multiple inflection points we could see in the near future. So immune oncology program, Clevegen, bexmarilimab, that is an official antibody name, targeting the Clever-1, the immune suppressive regulator of these macrophages. I will spend most of the time with these recent results. And obviously, we are extremely excited to take it further. I will also mention something about the organ protection and the use of the interferon beta, not only in the collapsed lungs, but also in some other areas, which we believe is really important. And a few words about the stem cell therapy, which is evolving as well. So if you really think about it, what is the historical background of our cancer treatments today? You know, it was recognized already in ancient times that the cancer is not our friend. So they had some very interesting ways of treating them, but the surgical operations have been there and they are still with us today. Then century ago, radiotherapy started to become part of the treatments. And then post-war, the chemical companies had a lot of different chemicals which they learned to really control the cancer cell proliferation, and that brought up the chemotherapies. Then when the biology advanced, we started to understand what is behind of this proliferation. And then we came up with the tyrosine kinase inhibitors and monoclonal antibodies against the various receptors. And then the last decade has been really the revolution of these immune regulators called checkpoint inhibitors. These all are in use, but amazing thing is that if you really look at the end result, it's rather modest. If you now look at what increase of clinical benefit these checkpoint inhibitors, which are in the lips of all of us, have really produced, it's not that dramatic if you really look at the outcome. And it's unfortunate thing that only maybe 10 to 20, 25% at maximum really respond to these all these treatments. And if you really think about the outcome, we spend maybe 20, 25, some 50 billion or so US dollars on these drugs, and yet we still haven't really received even the satisfactory level of clinical benefits. So what we do, we target this receptor called Clever-1, which is a really interesting macrophage receptor, and we have now shown that we can actually control as a standalone treatment these solid tumors which are hard to treat. We have extremely positive safety data as well, meaning that it's really safe, and we have really obtained dose-limiting toxicities. We believe that we have a significant combination potential as well and really challenge the current treatments. And we have a really good patent position, as I said earlier. So what we have learned during the recent year or so, when we initially targeted the macrophages, which is on the top of the left side, those type 2 macrophages, which are the immune suppressive cells, are also active in some of the physiological settings. The best example being the pregnancy, when the mother needs to build immune suppressive environment for the embryo so that mother's host immune system would not really destroy or kill the embryo. They are using these same cells to build the immune barrier in the placenta. Now tumors have picked this up and used the same system, and they attract a regulatory T cells around together to penetrate the tumor, and then they build the immune suppressive environment. the Clevecen treatment with bexmarilimab, we actually convert these immune suppressive cells into immune activators. And that's what is really important. Then we learned that not only this Clever-1 is on the surface of these macrophages, it's also liberated or released to the circulation. So it's in all the locations of these patients. And there we have learned that it actually can inactivate the T cells, the most potential defense cells we have in all of us. So we have a two steps of better ways of controlling the tumor growth locally, but also in the remote locations. And obviously that is a very beneficial for the patients. So we have done a number of animal experimentation and shown that this is very effective. When we remove the Clever-1, none of the tumor cells can grow in those animals. When we control them with the antibodies, what is the bexmarilimab or surrogate molecule, we can actually demonstrate that it's even better than PD-1 inhibitors, one of those checkpoint inhibitors. Melanoma treated as well. And then more recently, we have also learned that we can control these leukemia cells, which are myeloid origin, which is the same family of original bone marrow cells and also carrying a significant amount of Clever-1 on their surfaces. So this all means that we have really a significant impact already from the animal experimentation. And if you then look at the genetic background of the humans, look at in the middle of this slide, you can see that if you have a high expression of Clever-1, that is the red curve, you are almost resistant against the current immune therapies. The blue ones where there is a low expression of Clever-1 are responsive. Again, telling us a signal that we need to really get these immune suppressive cells in control and help the body to reactivate their immune system. And that's what we have been doing. We also learned from the animal experimentation that we can turn what they called cold tumors, meaning that the leukocytes, our defense cells, are not migrating into the tumor and initiate the fight against the tumor. That we have seen in the animal experimentation, and that's on the left side. But if we then look at the Matin's patients, we can also see that we can activate them and get the leukocytes to migrate to the tumor, meaning that we can actually get them hot again, meaning that we can activate, hopefully, the immune system against the tumor antigens. And on the right-hand side, you can see part one data where 7 out of 30 patients already responded this way. Obviously, very exciting data. But then one complication was that we were using 3-week interval in our dosing regimen. And if you look at the soluble Clever-1 now in the plasma of these patients, we observed that the frequency must be increased because this 3-week interval is not removing effectively enough the soluble Clever-1. And when we follow these negative checkpoint inhibitors, we see the same thing, that they only go down for a week, but then they come back, meaning that by increasing the frequency, we can actually hopefully even increase the efficacy of this treatment even more. So macrophage-focused therapy, showing a survival benefit, you can see that in a minute. We specifically affect only these M2 macrophages, which carry Clever-1, we leave alone the other ones, and it has a transformative effect on T cells, as I showed a moment ago. Now we have analyzed further patients from the part two and learned that there is a group of responders which have a remarkable extension of their survival benefit. We have now been able to follow them up to 6 months. This was roughly 140 patients. And we also observed that there is a certain groups of the patients who have a significant benefit. Those are cutaneous melanoma patients, gastric cancer, and cholangiocarcinoma. There we had a survival benefit that was up to 1/3 of the patients, which have not, nobody has been in this a refractory proportion of the patients. Remember, these patients had no options anymore we are treating, and that we observed in our trial as well, because the progression of the cancer at the previous treatments were pretty much the same in all of the patients, even we have these responders. So this is a very significant finding. And obviously, this now helps us to really design the final pivotal part of this MATINS trial. So MATINS at the moment is like a platform for us. There we can test different dosings, frequencies, and then take the promising cancers, like said on the left-hand side, to the pivotal part. We may then expand those up to 30 patients, test a further different dosing levels, then pick up the best dose levels, go to the regulators like indicated here to FDA, and then ask what size of the pivotal trial they actually would ask to run in order to get probably the conditional approval even to the market. And we have indicated here some timelines, and we are not that far away from really getting there. Obviously, this is extremely important, but that's not all. So taking out these three first indications, it's just the beginning. At the same time, we are carrying out the combination study with the standard of treatment in the lung cancer, and that is a PD-1 inhibitor. Then we are also expanding our colorectal testing into a neoadjuvant treatment. There, we would be giving the first dose prior to the surgical operation, allowing us to get access to the tumor in order to show that they are turning hot. Remember, hot meaning that the leukocytes are traveling to the tumor. That would tell us that we can really impact these rather resistant colorectal cancer patients also to the other treatments. Because when you get the leukocytes to penetrate the tumor, it usually helps really also in all the combination therapies. And then finally, really would like to take forward also the acute myeloid patients. And that is a very interesting because there we can monitor the patients immediately after the dosing daily, weekly, and so on, in order to really follow how and what kind of impact we have when we have a bexmarilimab really administered to these patients. So the aims are really high at the moment, but we are highly motivated based really on these results what we have had. But we are not forgetting the other ones. Many of the cancer patients may have bone marrow silenced by the treatments or some other reasons. So we want to activate that, and that is exactly what our hematokine program is doing. Targeting this AOC3 inhibitor or VAP1 has a significant ex vivo stimulation capacity really to make the hematopoietic stem cells to multiply. We more recently have also shown that if you use these inhibitors, you can actually even prevent the tumor growth shown on the right-hand side. So it looks like Faron profile is turning into more a cancer-related activities, and that's just fine. We accept that well. But then at the end, also, we would like to utilize the capacity of interferon beta to control a number of different conditions. So we believe that this, once we have shown, will be the very first product really to help where these central organs are really suffering from a sudden injury caused by COVID-19 or some other viruses like influenza, but at the same, anything from trauma to surgical operations. And if that is the case, we believe that we can also control some other conditions where this cytokine release syndrome may play a significant role. And one very interesting application would be CAR T therapy, where the patients are known to suffer this cytokine release syndrome. And obviously, we believe that again, with the interferon beta, we can control that. Again, very interesting, a strong IP position, and now building up also our own production and manufacturing capacity for interferon. We just believe that we can expand this program into a number of conditions. And this has been ongoing on the background while we have been setting up the Hibiscus trial, for which we got a DOD grant as well. That's about the beginning. We should get the first patient in any day. And then obviously expansion of these to number of other conditions. And remember, interferon beta is our natural defense molecule. I have often compared that to diabetes. In diabetes, you lose the production of insulin. So what we do? we supplement those patients with exogenous insulin. Here, the patients may have a problem with their own production of interferon beta by our mesenchymal cells called fibroblasts. And if you don't have that capacity, you are more vulnerable against these all conditions that the viruses, bacteria, and other conditions can actually produce. So as a summary, we just believe that the company is much better positioned now than ever before. And obviously, we are very excited when we move on with the Matins trial and with those individual other clinical trials. And we are really looking forward to produce and announce additional data later this year. Thank you very much for listening to me today.
You're welcome. You're going to have to contain that excitement though, Marco, aren't you? Because the FDA meeting is not mooted till 2022, 6 months' time. So one of our first questions is, do you have an office in the US? If not, why not? Because it would be good if the FDA could just like pop in for a cup of coffee if they need any more information.
We are just about to make the first hire in US and then building up it. The corona, unfortunately, has a little bit delayed some of the things because you can't really fly over there so frequently we did previously. But you are absolutely right. We want to be next to the sites who are doing these trials. Now we have both the Hibiscus and the Matins sites over there. And then obviously FDA, you need to have phone really to ring in and use that communication. And having open IND with both of these projects, definitely something that we would like to communicate with FDA. And also, you know, one day maybe we may have some other activities over there as well. But building US unit is absolutely our significant goal for this year.
Okay, so you talk about Hibiscus there, which is an acronym for the human intravenous interferon beta last safety and preliminary efficacy in hospitalized subjects with coronavirus. Hibiscus, you said in your presentation that you're going to have the first patient any day. Can you be any more specific? Are we talking about tomorrow?
Actually, today in US time, we had a site initiations visit, and obviously soon after a visit, everything should be in place. So yes, it should be tomorrow or anything from now on.
Very good. I'm wondering if that's worth an RNS. Any case, on to Gavin Norwood's question. Do you have any hypothesis yet on why there were no responders in the uveal melanoma cohort, or why some cohorts are responding better than others?
That is a key goal for us in the near future. Now we have so many patients treated and analyzed, and we have a significant amount of data on different biomarkers, cytokines, some a leukocyte a biomarkers that indicate the changes in those patients. We are absolutely interested in learning which population is more sensitive than the other ones, because that would allow us to really pick up those and enrich the population even further. The uveal melanoma was originally identified as a possible candidate because they do have a significant amount of these clever one positive macrophages. Is that amount too high for our current dosing regimen? In other words, maybe the 3-week interval is not really enough, or 1 mg/kg. We probably will go back to that target later on. But today, obviously, the focus has to be those who have already given the signal of response.
Okay, because Kevin Hudson was saying, dear Marku, uveal melanoma was previously seen as a promising target tumor type. Are there any mechanistic insights into why or no or few responses to date, which probably needs a couple more sentences from you, Marku?
Right. As I said, that is a very interesting kind of a cancer because it's deadly. There are no treatments today for it. And obviously, that would be a very suitable if there are so many clever one positive macrophages in those patients, especially around the metastasis, usually in the liver. And we are not forgetting it. But in this dose testing we have now carried out, we didn't have a responders. So it means that either we need to increase the dosing or then really try to understand why they are so different. Because we have had candidates also in the colorectal, in some other ones besides of those we listed, even in the ovarian. So we just need to study them further. And that's the reason I'm saying that this Matins trial is kind of platform for us, where we can now play around with the dosing and then come to the conclusion which is a most optimal for all of these different types. Maybe majority of them would be just satisfied with a one same dosing regimen, but maybe some of them may want to have more. And this neoadjuvant treatment, the dose testing will be taken up as much as we can. We go first to 10 mg per kilo, 10 to 30 mg per kilo. That is a significant amount of bexmarilimab, and see what really happens in those patients and how much really need that we can really activate the silenced immune system.
Matt Kay asks, dear Marku, what is the status of the colorectal arm and the increased dosing frequency?
That is still under a review. We had these first 10 patient cohorts, and obviously we will be reporting on those. The colorectal have, if I recall correctly, at least two clinical benefiters at the moment. But what is the final outcome? It's to be reported as well.
Okay, so you're very excited. This is possibly going to be the transitional year that Faron has been leading up to. And Tommy asks, can Marku give shareholders an idea of what sort of monetary value Faron places on its own therapies based on comparable deals done within the industry?
Significant more than the market cap is today. obviously, that is a key thing. But for example, now, looking at those three cancer cohorts, we can actually model that now. We know what line of the treatment we can actually go in. And as, for example, for the gastric cancer, there's really no treatment at the moment. And also cholangiocarcinoma, that is a deadly condition. Patients usually die within the half year time or so. So if you have any benefit, you can really build up the kind of a models, really also think about it. And as I said, it actually should be recognized by the markets as well.
Now, when you choose a broker, they're usually known for being good at certain things. So you've chosen Peel Hunt as a new broker. Have you gone to them because they're experts on mergers and acquisitions, for example, or for fundraising?
They are, and also with the institutional investors, which we will hope to be really join kind of the shareholder basis. That is something. And then we have probably really looking for a additional resources, really, you know, become more active. And we have done that also in Scandinavia, not only in the UK.
Right. On to one of Tim's questions, with its many clauses. Tim Grattan asked, could you expand on the regulatory news statement issued on May the 14th and the need to sub-license IP in order to have freedom to operate? Who owns this patent, and how long have you been aware that you would need a sub-license? And I'll come back to the rest of his question.
It is a very interesting situation. The original filing was done by the Japanese Cancer Institute 1981 or something like that, so some 40 years ago. And then when the US changed their patent system, they joined the PCT, globally accepted way of filing patents nowadays. There was a possibility to extend the open and not closed patents into a new system, and that's what they did with this. The major license holder is Bayer, and that's the reason why we had to make the license deal. This is only US-related patent, and it's on the CDA of the interferon beta. So if you want to produce interferon beta for US markets, you need to have a license for this one. And we just are so close of getting there. We then set and analyzed the situation and said that it's better for us really to get the license and then have a full freedom really to operate. We also have a significant amount of additional IP produced by ourselves, and that is already there. But this was really a kind of a important for us to have freedom to operate in the US now when we are getting more and more close to the markets.
More and more close to the markets. Tim's also asking, does this third-party patent affect all IV formulations, both lyophilized and ready constituted?
It's the same drug substance used in both of them. So it's really to produce the interferon beta from the recombinant sources. And that's the process we have been building now for a year or so since Rensselaer terminated the previous agreement with us. And obviously that litigation is ongoing and we hope to sort that out this year as well.
Okay, well, going back to the hibiscus trial associated with COVID-19, Gavin Norwood's asking, you know, is there a reason why hibiscus is now focused just on COVID? Because he thought the original design was to include other acute respiratory conditions, and he says we know it works on them from post hoc analysis.
That is definitely the plan we have, and I can say that, for example, DOD is definitely interested in ARDS, not COVID-19, because the ARDS is a condition which you can easily get after the trauma, and obviously they have an interest in helping any of the injured patients from the battlefield. But obviously this is applicable to any of the trauma patients after car accidents, and so that is absolutely the goal. It just happens that there are kind of a lot of need for these COVID patients, and we may be expecting to have also influenza season post-COVID, and we still have the same problem. There's no help for this lung injury at the moment. We put them into ventilators, but it doesn't often help, and people die. And now when this corticosteroid use is kind of a bit loose, so to say, to be polite, in India now they have observed that you actually may get additional infections because you suppress their immune system with the corticosteroids. This black fungus being one example, but there may be some other examples. So I think we need to learn to really use these drugs wisely. And our recommendation is really to use interferon beta first and then corticosteroids if they are still needed. And we really stick with this plan.
Okay, this is quite a high level question here. Tommy asks, how important will screening for the single nucleoid polymorphism be in the future planned use of tromokine?
It will help to identify those patients who are resistant to corticosteroid effect on interferon beta signaling pathway. There's a population of us, one third in the Caucasian population, original Africans, maybe 40%. In Far East, it's a really mild number of people, so they actually are very vulnerable for corticosteroid treatment against the viral infections. And there are some reports from China, people have overlooked them, but the mortalities are really high when corticosteroids are used on those populations. So I would be really careful in India, in Asia, really to use corticosteroids, because we know that they do not carry this single nucleotide mutation or polymorphism, and we hopefully can come up with additional scientific information very soon. We have been working really hard to look at what it means if you have these polymorphic forms.
Okay, going back to the main excitement, although all your platforms are very exciting, Christopher Webb saying, what is the realistic timescales now for partnering with Clevedon, as you seem very excited by its progress?
Well, obviously, the pressure really increases all the time. And as said many, many times, we are surrounded by a very significant players. When would be the most optimal time really to do? We are so close to get really exciting data. Would that be best for the shareholders? Because when you do too early the partnering, you may not have the value at the end of the day, which you hope to have. And we are balancing with that. We definitely are balancing and discussing with the board and with our advisors all the time. So yes, we are aware of this. We are aware of this, that using a partnering and licensing activities would help us really to expand. And maybe one day we get to the point where we really would like to have a partner, and then it's time to do it.
Okay, well, you mentioned value there. Tommy asks, on a scale of 1 to 10, how much extra value has the soluble Clever One discovery given to potential negotiations?
A significant amount, because it's a direct T cell inhibitor. It interacts with the immunological synapses, and that's where all the PD-1, PD-L1, LAG-3, you just name them, are forming the complex. And if this soluble syndicon actually can prevent this formation, it prevents the activation of T cells. And that's what we are seeing. So it's absolutely needed to be removed from those cancer patients. And if it needs a higher dosing or higher frequency, we just do it. It was extremely valuable. So I think it's more than 5. It may be 7, 8, really, to understand. And this is a very smart way by the tumors, really, to try to shut off the immune system already in the remote places. That would probably aid to form the metastasis, because they actually pave the way for their, you know, kids, children, to move to the next location and then build the metastasis over there.
Unfortunately, we're now overrunning, Marku.
Oh, thank you.
But interesting about the history, radiotherapy, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, checkpoint inhibitors, Faron Pharmaceuticals.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. There's a lot more questions come in, so if you could do a follow-up video, that would be great, because I know that Philip Stern is asking some really juicy questions that need a bit of thought. So,
We are here. Thank you.
Marku Jalkanen, Chief Executive of Faron Pharmaceuticals. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Good to see you.
Thank you.